Thank you very much, Sara, for the introduction. So hello, everybody, and thank you for the opportunity to present here today. So as you can get from the title of this project, so this is a joint project with Massimo Morelli and Margherita Negri, who are also following the presentation, and they will help with questions. So this is as you can get from the title of the project, the idea of this paper is to study, both from a theoretical and an empirical point of view, how electoral rules affect immigration policy. So how affect the borders of countries toward the arrival of migrants. So let me start with the motivation of this project. So the first motivation, the first part of the motivation comes from the literature. So there is an extensive literature in political economy that study how different institutions and specifically electoral institutions or electoral system affect different types of policy outcomes. So among the many that you can find the literature, you find an effect of electoral system on redistribution policy, on the structure of political parties, on labor market policy, and also corruption. So what is the contribution that we want to make to this literature is to study how electoral system can affect immigration policy. So we claim in this project that electoral system can have an effect on immigration policy. And let me first of all describe you the characterization of electoral rules that we study in this paper. So this is a characterization that is also already present in the political science literature, in particular in this reference of Riker from 1992, where the distinction is between two broad categories of electoral system. The first category is what we call sufficient plurality. So these are electoral system such that to control the majority, the absolute majority of seats in a parliament and form a government, you just need a plurality of votes. So it's not necessary to have an absolute majority of votes during an election. The typical example of this type of system are like the first past the post system, like the one that is used in the UK. So if you take the result of election in the United Kingdom, you might notice that normally the first party usually never gets more than 50% of the vote. Even though this is the case, this party is normally able to use to form a government alone without forming coalition, and so this party is able to have more than 50% of the seats without winning more than 50% of the vote. So this is the what we call sufficient plurality. In the second category, we have those systems that we call necessary majority. So these are systems that force whoever wants to form a government whoever wants to form a government through having at least 50% of the seat in the parliament to win at least 50% of the votes in an election. So the typical example of this kind of system are the proportional electoral system, where if you want to form a government through one single party or through a coalition, you need at least to win 50% of the votes, but also the dual ballot electoral system, where the classical example of a dual ballot electoral system, perhaps the most famous around the world, is the system used for the election of the French president. So in this system, you have you have two rounds. If one candidate wins at least 50% of the vote in the first round, is directly elected president. If nobody of the candidate win at least 50% of the votes in the first round, the first two candidates go to the second round, and the one that get more than 50% of the vote is then elected. So this is another example of a system that force whoever want to form a government to have at least 50% of the vote. So this is a characterization that is broader than the typical comparison that you find in the political economy literature, where normally the classical comparison is a plurality system versus a proportional electoral system. So why we want to study this characterization of these two categories of electoral system in relation to immigration policy, the the motivating evidence is the one that I'm going to show you in the next graph. So in the next slide. So this is evidence from data from OECD countries, and what we can observe. So this is descriptive evidence on between on the relationship between these two types of electoral system and what we can call and migration variable. So essentially what I'm showing you here is on the top, we have both the inflow of immigrants every 1,000 inhabitants and the stock of immigrants every 1,000 inhabitants for OECD countries for the period that goes from 2000 up to 2018. And what we observe here is that country with an electoral system that under the label necessary majority seems to be more open than country with electoral system that we label sufficient plurality electoral system. And a similar evidence apply also to asylum seekers and refugees. So what I'm showing in the bottom graph is both the share of accepted asylum application and the total number of accepted application every 1,000 inhabitants, so the accepted application per capita. And we can see that especially in the year of the refugee crisis, during which migration became a much more salient issue, we observe a similar evidence. So the necessary majority countries, so country with a necessary majority electoral system, appear to be more open than country with a sufficient plurality electoral system. So given this descriptive evidence, what we do in the paper in a nutshell. So we develop a theoretical model that rationalizes this evidence country with a necessary majority electoral system appear to be more open, and then we try we test it empirically with data from one country using a setup that we find in Italy that allow us to provide the causal evidence. Let me give you in a nutshell what is the idea of the model. So the idea of the model is that immigrants affect the welfare system and are believed to have a negative effect on wages. Let me stress that this is important. This is something I will repeat also in the model. So in the model, we will have that immigrants have a negative effect on the wages of worker, but this we will have the same result just having this effect in expectation. So it's not necessary that immigrants effectively have a negative effect on wages. It's sufficient that worker and or natives in general expect the effect of immigrants to be negative on wages. So given this expectation, we have three classes of natives, and depending on the potential effect of immigrants on both welfare and wages, we can order the preferences of these three classes in relation to their openness to immigration. So what is the ranking that we have? So essentially, and which are the three classes that we model? So the first class is what we call the out class. They essentially are individual outside the labor force, which are mainly pensioners and inactive individuals. So individuals that do not work and do not look for a job. And so the potential effect of immigration for them is only on the welfare system. Then we have the working class, which are essentially individual in the labor force. They can be both individual that already have a job or unemployed that are actively looking for a job. So these are employees and autonomous workers. And these are a class of workers that essentially do not hire other workers and they all look for a job from themselves. And the idea is that they are affected both through the welfare system and they expect a negative effect of immigrants on their wages. And then the third class is what we call the managing class, that are employers and managers. So those individuals who hire other workers, and because of the potential effect or the expected effect of immigrants on wages, this class have a positive expectation from the arrival of immigrants because they expect to, because of the negative effect on wages, they expect to benefit from that because they can pay or expect to pay a lower wages to the worker that they hire. So essentially the idea of the model is that The effect on the welfare system and on benefits is the same for the three classes, but because of the expected negative effect on wages, the working class is the class which is less open to migration. The out class, because they don't have any effect through the labor market, they are the intermediate class, and the managing class is the one which is more open to migration. And then how do we relate this to the electoral system? The idea is that if the working class, as we will say, we will show in the model, is the biggest class, and we will show that this is the case both in the modeling and in the data, is the biggest class, with a sufficient electoral system, this class have a higher chance to call the shot alone, so to win and form a government alone without forming any coalition. While with a necessary majority electoral system, this is not necessarily the case. And actually, we show that the out class becomes the relevant class with this other type of system. So the idea is that if the working class is the closest one, you will have that, given that the sufficient plurality system allow this class to form a government alone, you will have that the sufficient plurality system will be more closed than a necessary majority electoral system. So we formalize all this reasoning in our model, and then we test it through the Italian setup, which I will describe later. So now, if there are no question on the introduction, I will go more in detail in the model. So in the model, we have two countries that differ only for the electoral system. Every country has a mass one of native individual, and the country have to decide whether to allow immigrants to enter. So the decision is a 0-1 decision. So it's a closed open border decision. So Q is equal 0-1 in the sense that the country has to decide whether to close the border or open the border. If the immigration level in the country by capital Q that goes from zero to small Q. Each individual is characterized by a type theta, we have type theta, a parameter theta that goes from zero up to theta bar. So essentially the idea here is theta is capturing the skills or the productivity of the individuals. And then we have that this type is taken from a uniform distribution, while the distribution of immigrant is a function h theta. As I said in the introduction, we have three possible classes, so three possible occupations, and they differ for their the characterization of these three classes is through the gross income that they earn potentially in the labor market. So you have the managing class, whose income is a function of the difference between what they can produce, so capital F production function, which is a function of their type theta, so their productivity, their skill, and the labor demand that they want to hire, minus the cost that they have to pay to the labor that they hire, so which is the product of the labor demand multiplied by wages. Then you have the gross income of the working class, which is essentially their wage multiplied by their type theta. And then we model the out class, so the inactive individual and pensioner has not having any labor income. The individual in the managing class and the working class that's want to find a job, they find a job in the labor market with a probability phi of theta, and they also have a cost that they have to pay for searching for a job, which is a cost C, which is a positive cost. Labor income is then taxed at a rate tau that goes from 0-1, and the taxes that are raised by the government are used to distribute benefits to the entire population, so are used to pay for the welfare system. Now, as you can see in this characterization, the benefits are also a function of the migration level. So migration has an effect also on the benefits on the welfare system that can be distributed to the entire population. So combining the gross income that I show you in the previous slides with taxation and benefits, we get the expected net income of the three occupations. So essentially we have the first line is the expected net income of the employers, which is essentially so what they get from their gross income if they with a positive probability find a job minus taxation plus the benefits and minus the cost that they have to pay for being in the labor market. Same thing for the working class. So after paying taxes and having found a job with a positive probability, they remain with this net income, which is equal to the income they receive from the job plus benefit minus the cost of finding a job. And for the outclass, the only essentially net income that they receive is the benefit through the welfare system. The equilibrium, so I didn't mention at the beginning, so the equilibrium is taken from an existing paper by Austin Smith. So essentially, this is an expected sorting equilibrium. The definition of equilibrium is such that given a tax rate tau from 0 and 1 and given the number of immigrants then that enter to the country, the unexpected sorting equilibrium is a wage rate such that we have that labor demand equal labor supply and all the occupational choices are optimal. So what do we get in this expected sorting equilibrium? Essentially, we get that there are two types, theta 1 and theta 2, where the parameter so theta 2 is greater than theta 1, such that so these two parameters identify the individuals that are indifferent, theta 1 between being in the work between being between the working class and the outclass. So essentially the outclass goes from 0 to theta 1. Then you have the working class between theta 1 and theta 2 and the managing class that goes from theta 2 up to the maximum level of theta. So essentially you have that the three classes are ordered along this parameter theta, which capture skills or productivity. So essentially you have that the outclass are the less skilled individual, the working class are the intermediate individuals, and the managing class are those that are more skilled or more productive.
May I just ask a question here?
Yes.
So on the probability of finding a job, this does not depend on the quantity of migrants, right? So the only thing that migrants are going to do is that they lower the wages, but they do not affect the probability of being employed.
Okay, I think this is better if Margherita or Massimo jump in on this.
Yes, I can take this. No, that's correct. We have this very simplifying assumption that it only depends on your type. Having a proper model of the effect of migration on the labor market would probably be too complicated for our purposes.
Good. And then a second question is the fact that you're showing that depending on the productivity theta, you are in the alt class or working class or managerial. So how do you think about people that are retired? So they are along all the productivity distribution that they become retired, or you assume that basically they lose their productivity when they are too old and that's why they're in the lowest group?
Well, I think, Margherita.
Yes, so
I'll take this one.
Okay.
So basically, from the point of view of the preferences on the immigration policy, what matters is that the retired people are not contributing to the labor market. So you can effectively count them as theta equals zero.
Okay, yeah, that's right. Thank you.
Okay, thank you both. Okay, so I was at this point. So let me describe the voting. So essentially, the decision to admit migrant is made by majority rule within the parliament. We have three parties that represent the three classes, and the goal of the three parties is maximizing the expected utility of the average member of their class. So we have the two electoral systems. So the sufficient plurality, as I described in the introduction, is such that the party that obtain a plurality of votes, so they don't need the majority of votes, they win the majority of seats and form a single party government. With the other system, the necessary majority system, you need an absolute majority of votes to form. So if one party wants to form a single party government, this party will need an absolute majority of votes. If no party passes this threshold of the absolute majority of votes, then the decision on immigration must be supported at least by two parties. Now, we have a series of assumptions behind all the models. So one is that the managing class is less than one third. And this is something that in the data we can show, in the data, in the Italian data that we use, we show that we can show that this is the case. Then we have that the distribution of the type of migrants, age of theta, is such that natives believes that immigrants decrease wages. So this is the important thing that I was mentioning at the beginning. So we can interpret the model such that that in expectation, natives expect a negative effect of the arrival of migrants on wages. It's not necessarily the case that this effectively happened. And this is also to connect the model to all the literature, the empirical literature that show that natives usually have misperception on the migration topic. And then, so what we have is that the average expected income of the working class is increasing in wage, while the average expected income of the managing class is decreasing in wage. So if immigrants have an expected negative effect on wages, you will have that the working class expect to be damaged and the managing class expect to benefit from the arrival of migrants. And this is what I'm saying here. So when immigrants enter the country, and this effect is what drives the preferences of over immigration of the three classes. So when immigrants enter the country, you have that all classes are equally affected through the benefit system, through the welfare system. However, you have that the working class is the one that suffers more due to the decrease in wages, and the managing class is the one that potentially benefits more because of this potential or expected decrease in wages. So essentially what we have that the party that represents the out class will favor immigration if immigrants have a weakly positive effect on benefits. The party of the working class is normally the one always more opposed to immigration, or is always more opposed to immigration than the party of the out class because of this expected negative effect on wages, while the party of the employer, the managing class, is the one that is more open to immigration. So essentially, if we take these preferences and we plot the relationship of these preferences over immigration on the parameter theta, on the parameter of the skill, on the productivity, what we find is that this function should have what we call a J-shaped relationship between the average ability and the position of immigration. Why J-shape? Because essentially we expect the out class, which is the one with the lower probability, to be more open than the class in the middle, which is the working class. So you expect the function to go down. And then once you move to the managing class, you expect the function to go up again. So because the managing class will be the more open toward migrant. And this leads to the main result of the model, which is the one in proposition one. So the main result is essentially that given the preferences of a migration and given the electoral system using the country, we find that there exists no scenario in which the country with a sufficient plurality is more open to immigration than a country with a necessary majority electoral system. So the result is that or either the two countries have exactly the same immigration policy, or the sufficient plurality country closes its border while the necessary majority country keep the border open. And this second point happened when the working class is the one the more opposed to immigration. The party of our class, the outclass party, is more open to migration than the working class. And the composition of the population is such that the working class is the relative majority, but not the absolute majority. So the working class is the biggest group, but is not above 50% of the population. So why is this the case? When we have this condition that the two countries decide to implement different immigration policy, the intuition is that when you have this composition of the population, essentially the key decision player, so the key political party in the two systems is different. So when you have this composition of the population in the sufficient plurality country, the working class is a plurality, but not an absolute majority, but they can win alone, they can form a government alone and then close the border. While in the other system, with the necessary majority, you have that the working class cannot form a government alone. The out class become the relevant party and they can potentially form a coalition with the managing class and then keep their border open. In all the other situations in which you don't have this composition of population, which essentially are situations in which or the working class is above 50%, or the working class is not the biggest party and the outclass is the biggest party, you will get that the key party is exactly the same between the two electoral systems. So the key decision maker is the same. And so you will get that the two systems have exactly the same immigration policy. So that's why we get in this proposition that or either the two countries have the same immigration policy, or you have that the necessary majority country has a more open immigration policy than the sufficient plurality one. Okay, so this is the first part of the model. Then we show how the model can be applied also to the context that we use to test causally our model. So what is this context? The context is the context of Italian municipality. Why we study Italian municipality? For two reasons. First reason, we have a nice variation, a nice threshold in which the electoral system change. So we have that when you move above the 15,000 inhabitants threshold, you have a change in the electoral system such that municipality below the 15,000 inhabitant threshold use a plurality rule to elect the mayor. So it's a single round electoral system in which the candidate that gets the relative majority of votes is elected as a mayor. So essentially is what we call a sufficient plurality electoral system. While when you move above this threshold, you have a dual ballot electoral system. So this is a system that which essentially is like the system used for the French president. So you have a two-round electoral system. If a candidate wins 50% of the votes at the first round, is elected mayor. If no one of the candidates gets 50% of the votes, you have to go to the second round, and then you have a competition between the two top candidates, and the one that gets 50% of the vote is then elected mayor. So this is a system that's entering in the category that we call necessary majority electoral system. The second nice feature of the Italian context is that among the various way you can Italy allocate refugees and asylum seeker, there is one which is called the protection system for asylum seeker and refugees, which from now on I will call SPRAR. So the short version of the name. The nice feature of this system is that decision of opening a refugee center is in the hands of the mayor. So it's a decentralized decision at the municipal level. So how does exactly this system works? So you have that when the Home Office want to allocate asylum seeker refugees through this system, the Home Office issue a call for competition, a tender. And the mayor have to submit a bid they have to compete in this system, submitting a bid. So a bid is a proposal for a management of a refugee center, a proposal that will have the potential services that will offer, a description of the services that will offer to refugees and asylum seeker, together with the cost. So it's a proper competition. And these bids submitted by the mayors, so it's the mayor that decides to submit the bid. And these bids are then evaluated nationally by a committee of the Home Office. And the municipality that win the competition open the center and receive also fiscal grants from the central government in exchange for opening the center. So what we do with the model now, we adapt this general model that I describe up to now to this Italian system. So the idea is that we will have instead of having two countries, we will have two municipalities, one with a sufficient plurality electoral system and one with a necessary majority electoral system. And then the party and the three classes will be exactly the same with the same preferences of a migration. The only difference is that in this case, the migration policy will be work in a way similar to this tender competition that works through the SPRAS system. So essentially you have that the mayor has to decide to submit a bid. The bid, it works as it normally works in auction. The municipality that submit the lower bid will win the auction. So the lower bid could be, you can think as a lower bid as proposing of managing a refugee center for a lower cost than your competitors. And essentially the idea is that you will have that the more open is the class that supported the mayor or the mayor representing the class with a more open preferences for migration will submit a lower bid. And through this, we get to the second proposition of our model, which explain the result related to this application of the model to the Italian context. And essentially, the result will recall the one that we have already seen in proposition one. The idea here is that when the working class is the relative but not the absolute majority of the population, you will have that the necessary majority municipality will be strictly more open because we submit a lower bid than the sufficient plurality municipality. And we show in the model that there are no other configuration of all the parameters such that this opposite strict openness ranking can happen. So essentially what I'm saying here is that or either the two municipality, depending on the composition population, submit the same bid and then they have the same probability of winning the competition and opening a refugee center, or the necessary majority under this condition of having the working class being the relative but not the absolute majority, the necessary majority municipality will submit a lower bid and then win the competition with a higher probability and then will be more likely to open a SPRAR refugee center. So essentially all of this says that as a prediction that we test then in our data is that we expect the difference in the probability of opening a SPRAR center to emerge both in the overall sample, so in the entire sample, and also in the subsample in which the working class is the relative majority but not the absolute majority. And this is the sample that from now on, and especially in the tables, in the regression, I will call stricter difference sample. In all the other cases, which is when the working class is above 50% or the outclass is bigger than the working class, you expect the relevant class to be the same in the two electoral system. And so you expect to not find any differences in the probability of opening a refugee center between the two type of municipality. So the remaining part of the subsample, which I will call no strict difference sample. Okay, so this concludes the theory, and now I can move to the empirical part. So the empirical part, before going directly to the exercise with Italian municipality, I will show you some evidence on what in the model we have called the J-Shay relationship. So what is the J-Shay relationship? So this is a descriptive evidence that we produce using survey data. So the idea here is that we say that if we plot a relationship between openness to migration and the skills of the three classes, so the parameter theta, we should expect a J-Shay function. So where we have that the working class will be the one most close to the arrival of migrant compared to the other two classes, and with the managing class being the more open. Now, the way we model this in the theoretical model is that this J-shape function we work through essentially to the economic dimension, so to the expected economic effect of migrants on the economy that will host them, and especially in the model works through differences in opinion relative to the potential impact of immigrants on the jobs of natives. So in the model, we have essentially that the working class has the most close position because they expect a more negative effect on their wages. So what I'm doing here, I'm showing you data from the 2011 ITANES survey. So it's a survey that interview people, respondent in Italy. And essentially what I'm showing you here is that the dependent variable in columns one and two is a continuous variable that essentially the respondents are asked whether they agree if immigrants are a threat for native jobs. And the potential answer goes from one to four, where one is strongly agree and four is strongly disagree. So the lower the answer they give, the answer they give, the more negative is the position. And then we do the same thing for the sentence is are immigrant a threat for the native culture. So what we observe here, both with covariates and with without and with covariates, is that through the economic question, so whether immigrants are a threat to native job, we find that consistent with our model, the working class is the one with the most negative opinion compared to the out class, and the managing class is the one with a more open opinion. While when we move to the cultural dimension, we still find that the managing class is the more open class. However, there are no differences between the working and the out class. I see Giuseppe with the hand raised.
Yeah. I didn't want to interrupt you, but I wanted to ask you a question. So if I understand correctly, you define the managing class as the employers because they are not perceiving a wage, right? They're not like managers who are employees, right?
We have also, in the managing class, we also have the manager. So the idea is that, so essentially, what we wanted to capture are two categories, working class and managing class, which differ because they can potentially be in competition with migrants. We don't expect managers to be in the working class because of this reason, and also because it's true that they receive a wage, but they also have the power to hire individuals. So that's why we put them in the managing class.
Okay, I was asking this because I saw that the expected income of the managing class was negative in the wage. So I was, you know, wondering if they were, you know, getting a wage as employees. And also, I wanted to ask you whether you have tried breaking down the working class into different skill levels to see if, you know, this is robust. And also, how do you split the class? Do you use like an ISCO code? You haven't told us how you split.
That's true. No, you're right. I didn't tell you. I mean, for a sake of time. So I've tried different things. As you can see here, I also mentioned that I use another survey, the European Value Survey. So in the case of the Itanes survey, I'm not using an ISCO code. They essentially, I mean, there is a direct question that asks you whether you are part of occupation that you can put into different classes. But with the other survey, I did the same exercise with using the ISCO code, and we find the similar results. On the thing of breaking down, so if I split more the classes, what I find is that this more negative opinion of the working class is more driven by the occupation that are more in the ISCO classification, those that are considered to be less skilled. For both this exercise and then more importantly for the next one, I think what we need and what is important to match in the empirical part with the model is that you get that on average you observe this J shape. So it's true that if you start to get work in a higher position in the skill ranking, eventually this negative effect, this more negative opinion will disappear. But I think this is consistent with our story. I mean, when you go down in the skill distribution, it's more likely that this worker expect to be in competition. I don't know if this answers your question.
No, it does. Yeah, the reason I was asking this in the first place is because if you have more groups, more coalitions can be formed, and that could probably, you know, be an element you may want to also control for. But you know. I don't want to take too much. We can talk later in the Q&A, maybe.
Okay.
Matteo, if I may, you have 5 minutes more left.
Okay. Okay. Let me try. So 5 minutes. Let me try to show you the RDD result. Okay. So I will skip this. So I guess most of you are familiar with the regression discontinuity design. So I will use the threshold to estimate the effect of one electoral system versus the other. controlling as with population as the running variable and calculating the optimal bandwidth in the standard way using the Calonico-Cattaneo T-Tunique optimal bandwidth selector. Okay, the data are data for a period from 2010-2017. The main regression will be run starting with a subsample for municipality between 10,000 and 30,000 inhabitants, because I want to avoid other threshold in which other policy changes. And data came mainly from the Italian Statistical Office and the Italian Home Office. The occupation, we measured the occupation using the 2011 census. Okay, so the first graph I'm going to show you is just to give you an idea of the relationship between the probability of opening a Sprat refugee center population and our 15,000 threshold. So what we observe is that, so what I'm plotting here are the dots are bean that's average across of ranges of 2,500 inhabitants. And then the function is, in this case, is a four-order polynomial. So what we observe here is that with population, the probability of opening a refugee center increases with population, and this might be intuitive. So bigger municipalities are more willing to host refugees. And interesting, what we find is that this function is discontinuous at the threshold where the electoral system changes. Then let me show you how we estimate the model. So this is the baseline effect of our empirical part. So we have column one and two, the entire sample. We find with both with, without, and with covariates, we find that a dual ballot electoral system, so a necessary majority electoral system, has a higher probability of a municipality with a necessary majority electoral system have a higher probability of opening a Sprat center. And then, as I explained in the model, we have that this result we expect to be driven by what we call the strict difference sample, which is essentially the sample in which the working class is the relative but not the absolute majority. When we move to all the other cases, we find no differences between the two type of municipality with different electoral system. And then to try to convince the reader that effectively the effect is due by a mechanism working through the economic worries of the working class, especially through the labor market worry. So what we do, we implement an heterogeneity analysis that seemed to confirm this intuition. So let me focus here for the sake of time only in columns 3, 4, 5, and 6. So what we do in column 3 and 4, we calculate the ratio of the three different classes. So we take the sum of the out class plus the managing class, and we calculate the ratio of this sum over the working class. So what we split the sample between municipality below the median of this ratio and municipality above the median of this ratio. So if the story in our model is the true one, we would expect the effect to be driven by municipality where this ratio is above the median. Why? Because when this ratio is above the median, it means that the out and the managing class approach in size the working class. And these are the cases in which expect the winner or the relevant class to be the working class in the sufficient plurality municipality. And we expect the combination of the out class and the managing class to be the relevant classes or the winner in the dual ballot municipality. And as we can see, this is the case. When this ratio is very low, we expect the winner to be always the same in the two type of municipality, so the working class. And then to provide evidence that this is due to economic concern, we do two additional exercises. First, in column 5 and 6, we split the municipality between those that were hit more by the Great Recession in the year 2007-2009. And those that were hit less. So essentially we take the growth rate during this period, and those that were hit more are those with a smaller growth rate below the median. So we potentially also a negative growth rate. And those that were hit less by the crisis are those that continue to grow during the crisis. And we see that the effect is driven by municipality in column 5. So those that were hit more by the crisis. So we which are those that we expect where economic concern should be, or the salience of economic issues should be higher, and potentially where the working class might be to be expect to be more in competition with migrants. And then to try to rule out additional mechanisms, we also, because you might expect the working class to be worried, I mean, the working class to be the one to have more children and to be worried that the arrival of migrants will put pressure on schools, and the kids of school will go, the kids of migrants will go to school with their kids. This might be a potentially alternative channel. So to try to rule out this, we split the municipality between those with a share of children below and above the median, and we see that we still find an effect in both type of municipalities. Okay, so then we have a series of robustness check, which I can discuss if you are interested. And let me just conclude. So we provide in this project theory and empirical evidence on how different electoral institutions affect immigration policy. The key insight of the paper is that different occupational classes can have different preferences on immigration policies. And the main idea is that if you have different electoral rules, this can give different power to different occupation. So essentially the idea is that even if you have countries with the same composition of the population, with the same share of the three classes, a different electoral system can give a different power to one of the three classes, and these produce different policy outcomes. And the result is that in general, you find that country or municipality with this necessary majority electoral system appear to be more open than country or municipality with a sufficient plurality electoral system. And we provide evidence, both cross-country and survey evidence, and then causal evidence with Italian data that support the prediction of our model. So thank you very much. So I'm done, and I guess we can open the conversation.
Thanks, Matteo, for the nice presentation. So seems that we don't have questions on the chat. So please, if you want to raise a question to Matteo, just use the raise your hand function, and I will give you the floor. So there is Q&A. So there is a question by Yuki Takahashi asking why there is a dip before the threshold. So I think he's referring to the figure. Yes.
Well, before let me stress that this variable, the variable we are using is a dummy variable, and this program is not really overcrowded. So you have that approximately you have in the data that around 8% of the municipality participate. So you can expect this variable to be a bit noisy, but as you can see, in the end here I'm plotting the function with a four order polynomial, and you still get that especially below the threshold is a bit linear. So I'm not sure this is a huge worry, but I'm not surprised that I get a bit of noise out of this dependent variable.
Maybe just a follow-up question on this image. Can you put confidence intervals?
Yes, I can do it. I'm not sure there was a recent discussion that this figure with the confidence interval a bit misleading, because sometimes you get that it seems they overlap, and then in the end the discontinuity is statistically significant. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure this helps really to have them, but potentially I can do it.
And then I have maybe another question, since I don't see any raised hand for the moment. It's more related to the interpretation. I mean, I don't know how it works in the Italian system, but can refugee typically work? And do you have any suggestive evidence or summary statistics of how many of these refugees coming in actually get employed in the municipality when they arrive?
Depending on the period, the law was changed at a certain point. Initially, they had a period of 6 months in which they could not work, and then this period was reduced to 60 days. One thing that I would like to stress about this PRAR system is that this is a second level of reception. So this is not meant to host those that are just arrived to Italy, but these are refugees and asylum seekers that already went through a first level reception, and the system is supposed to help them to integrate and find a job. So there are some data on the numbers, so aggregated statistics, that suggest they effectively at the end of the process they find out not all of them, but they have a probability of finding a job. So with this system, it's credible that this happened. I think the statistic is similar to what we have seen already in other paper in the literature, that probably they are less likely than other type of migrants. But through this channel, the final goal is that one. So it's a credible thing that they can be perceived as potential worker at a certain point.
Thank you.
Okay, so then I will ask a question. So Matteo, I have a question on the SPRAR system. So is there anything on the location of this center? So what I have in mind is, for instance, I don't know, you know, like you have a municipality opening a center and you know, close to another one, and then you might have some spillovers across municipalities or things like this, like can it be the case? Or even maybe can two municipalities team up to write a bid, and then just trying to understand how it works.
Okay, let me start with the second question, because I know a clear answer. The answer is yes. It happens sometimes that so what happened in Italy, that sometimes municipality form a union to provide services, and they can potentially apply also with a union to open these centers. So what I did with this municipality are two things. Where I could find information on municipality in the union, I also tried to look at which municipality exactly opened the center, and then code that municipality as the one that opened the center. Or the other thing is assigning the center to a municipality. The other question, I'm not sure what you have in mind, but I mean, there could be, of course, spillover. I mean, you can expect.
What yeah. I have in mind is like, let's imagine that we have a municipality where the working class is high, and we have another one where you have another type of municipality, because basically you have two types of municipalities, right?
Okay.
And what I have in mind is that, imagine, for instance, there is one municipality opening the center very close to another municipality of a different type. And I was thinking, like, I mean, could it be that there is some, I don't know, I mean, just I'm just thinking out loud. Maybe it's easy maybe to answer. I mean, if you have any information on how those are located across space.
Okay, so maybe provide a map to see.
Yeah, I mean, that might be, or yeah, maybe then you can even think about like playing with that information, right? I don't know how.
Okay, yeah, I'm not sure, but maybe. So maybe if your neighbor municipality open as percent, this might have an effect on your decision to opening or not. That could be an idea. Can you hear me?
No, my connection is unstable, so I missed what you said.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Now it's from my side, I guess, not okay. Yours.
No. I was saying, so maybe one idea could be if I know if the neighbor municipality has already opened a SPRAR center, if this had an effect on the process of the other municipality. So,
for instance.
No. Okay, so this is something I could investigate. Yes. Thanks.
All right. Okay. So Jesus Fernandez Huertas Moraga has a question.
Hi. Thanks, Luca. Thanks, Matteo, for a very nice presentation.
Thank you.
So I was wondering whether you are thinking of, or maybe you have already looked into other measures of migration policies at the local level. So I guess SPRAR might be the biggest thing that you can think at the local level, but maybe there is another measure of openness for which it would be interesting to see whether you see the same type of discontinuity. I mean, even going as simple as looking at the share of immigrants being hosted in a municipality or something like that. I don't know to what extent mayors or municipalities can control the number of people who come or can make their location more attractive to immigrants. Did you look at something else?
No, thanks for the comment. So we thought about that, but unfortunately, so mayor don't have power on other types of immigration flow. So you don't really expect them to have an effect on. I mean, it will be nice, of course, but the reason why we are focusing on this migration this type of policies is exactly that one. So it's because they have a direct power, while on other type of migration policy, as far as I know, they don't have a direct power. So you don't expect to find an effect on other variables, essentially.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks.
Okay. Then I think we are done. If nobody else has a question, then I will let the floor to Sarah to end the seminar.
Yeah. If Matteo, you can just unshare your screen, I'll just share the conclusion. All right. So thank you very much, Matteo, for this great presentation. I just want to close by remind that next week we'll have Charlie Porter presenting this paper on migration with costly information. And as you already know, you can see on our website the schedule for the next weeks. And we're still accepting submission for this semester, so do not hesitate to send us your paper if you're interested. Again, this year we have this new feature that you can be a panelist if you would like to interact more directly with the speaker. So we just ask you to read the paper in advance and to register to the seminar before Friday and to connect 5 minutes prior to start if you would like to be in the panel. So thank you very much for joining, and we hope you that we will see you next week.
Thank you very much.